zoom in
and see your slides, then we're ready. Okay, so let me just introduce Eleftherios. Eleftherios Garyfallidis is a member of the faculty in intelligence systems engineering at Indiana University, and Eleftherios has been the leader of an open source software project called Diffusion Imaging in Python. I've collaborated with him on this for many years, I should say. And he will tell us about this project in today's talk. Take it away, Eleftherios.
All right, thank you. Hi, everyone. And thank you for inviting me in NeuroHackademy. Looks like a very fun event. And so today I will talk to you about DiPi, which is a project for analyzing medical images, primarily diffusion images. I'm Eleftherios. I'm a good friend of Ariel Rokin for a long time. So it feels this space feels very friendly to me. And I'm also a professor in Indiana University, and I have my own research lab. So I do both maintain DiPi, but I have also my own personal research. All right, so what we're gonna talk today about? So the what, how, who, how, and why of DiPi. I will explain you, so what is DiPi, who is involved, and why we're doing what we're doing. I will talk to you a bit about new exciting features. And from all the things that DiPi can do, given this is only one lecture, I will talk to you about some progress we have in suppressing noise with diffusion data. I had to choose one topic because you will see it, DiPi can do a lot. All right. So what is DiPi? It's a software project for medical imaging analysis. Very importantly, if you're using DiPi, make sure you cite this paper from Frontiers in Neuroinformatics, DiPi Library for the Analysis of Diffusion MRI Data. And make sure also you cite any other methods that are used in DiPi. You will see what I mean in a bit. Okay, so here's how this project started, to understand a bit better what is DiPi and how much different it is from other projects in Python that you will learn this week. So there was this problem in early 2000 where people will take dead brains, what you see here on the left side, take dead brains and dissect them manually using what is called Klinger's dissectomy. And they would do that, and actually they have been doing that not only in early 2000, but before that, for decades before that, but they would see these paths. And those are bundles with axons in the brain, and try to give them names. So what we're trying to do with DiPi and with diffusion imaging, one of the main things we're trying to do is try to find that, get that information without using dead brains in vivo. By doing it in vivo, we use MRI data. And after a series of algorithms, we are able to reconstruct the pathways of the brain computationally. So this is a large task. It requires, as I said, many steps, and DiPi and other projects are trying to solve that or improve all the steps getting into achieving and obtaining really good visual reconstructions of the brain's connectivity and pathways. And what you can see here that some pathways that are virtually reconstructed by, when I say virtually, I mean we get real data from the MRI scanner, but then there is a computational process from a computer that regenerates these pathways. What you can see is many of them you can see also in the real brain. So many of the pathways reconstructed are representing pretty well the underlying anatomy. And so to get diffusion MRI data, you just need an MRI scanner. And the acquisitions, these types of acquisitions are available in most MRI scanners in the world. And as with fMRI, where you get 4D images, in diffusion MRI, the data sets are also four-dimensional. And when we say four-dimensional, they're simply stacks of 3D volumes. So there are many 3D images put together to create a four-dimensional data set. So the difference with fMRI is that each volume in fMRI is a different time step. You do something, you expect some activation, and that there is a dimension of time. So the last dimension is a dimension of time. Here, the last dimension is a difference in the gradient, in the gradients of the MRI scanner. So what is happening there is that when we build diffusion MRI acquisitions, there is an additional field that has different strength and orientation that is applied for each volume. So each volume gets this different magnetic field strength and orientation that is applied to it. That is what is changing how the images look. That difference, that it's called the diffusion gradients. The applied diffusion gradients that are different for each volume change how this volume looks. So then what we can do is look at one voxel and look at the gradient dimension, which is similar to the time dimension. And for each voxel, get the signal. As you see here, there is the signal. So you can have a signal per 3D position in the brain. After we have that signal, we can do some modeling. So we can do a modeling where we can reconstruct now a biophysical model, something that gives you some information about the underlying anatomy. For example, is there a region with some crossings, or is there some lack of a water compartment in that voxel? You can get different properties of the underlying anatomy at each voxel by analyzing this signal here. And that signal is different for every voxel. Then after you're doing that, what you can do, you can integrate information across voxels. And for example, you can build tractograms. So create tracks, connect the dots, connect this orientation distributions here, and build some tracks, and therefore create tractographies. You see an example here at the bottom of the slide. So, and that's only a few of the things you can do, but these are the two of the main things you use diffusion MRI for. So let's repeat here that the signal is typically represented by these 4D data sets that are stacks of 3D volumes. And you can do modeling, multi-compartment, spherical harmonic, and so on. And you can use it to reconstruct the white matter tracks in the brain, for example, and also other types of tissue. What is also really nice with diffusion MRI is that although you are sensing at the millimeter resolution, you can actually understand things that are in a lower resolution, submillimeter, even micrometer resolution. And that is, you can think of it as a type of compressed sensing that we can use to then, it's a combination of many things. It's compressed sensing, it's biophysical modeling, it's many things. Is that availability of the data sets for each different diffusion gradient data set, that the shape of that signal can tell us things that are in much lower resolution than what the actual voxel measurement is. So this is what I want to say here. So when I was a student myself, I was looking at the pipeline that is used for was used for diffusion MRI analysis. And what I realized is that many problems were open, and they were actually hard problems to solve. So for example, you will get the raw data, then you will do some kind of voxel reconstruction and model fitting, and then you will do tracking, and then after tracking, you probably need to do some kind of segmentation and get some tracks out, and then map them with some anatomical measurements. And after that, do some statistical analysis. So immediately I saw that there is a, that field had many steps, many processing steps, and it really needed an international effort to move forward. So many challenges. How can you resolve lower crossing angles? How you can reduce for voxel reconstruction? How can you reduce false positive phototography? How you can segment accurately tractograms? I mean, which metric to use? Which should we use, let's say, fractional anisotropy or mean diffusivity? And then how can you do statistical analysis? Many things here. And many, I don't say, for example, how can you pre-process the data? So all these challenges were not trivial. And I decided that it would be a good idea to try to have a project that runs across labs. It's not only one lab running it, it's across labs, and many people from different countries and so on can be involved. So then in 2009, we released the first version of DiPi. And here I want to give credit to the original team of contributors that I think everyone really helped to push the project. So I started the project together with Matthew Brett and Ian Emo Smith, who were my advisors at the University of Cambridge. And then Bago, Stefan, and Ariel joined from different universities. And if you see them, you will also recognize that some of them are also involved in many other projects. For example, Matthew is working on NiBubble, and Stefan in Scikit Image. So, we had that original team of contributors, and we released DiPi, and the team grew and grew. Now, today we have 120 contributors, around 120 contributors from over 15 countries. And we managed to achieve some funding from different funding agencies. And the project is moving forward. We have also a software engineer who helps with maintenance, who is paid primarily to work on DiPi. So very important for DiPi is established ecosystem that DiPi can cooperate with. So if we now for a bit put DiPi at the center, we can see that it does a lot of image processing, and for that is using NumPy arrays as the main data structure. And that gives us some flexibility, and we can connect to machine learning libraries for the machine learning algorithms that are not in DiffBy. We can use scikit-learn and TensorFlow. We can also use computational anatomy-related tools like NiBubble. I should also say here that DiffBy is part of, is one of the early projects of the Neuroimaging in Python organization. Now, because the project has grown a lot, we made our own organization, but we're still working closely with a Neuroimaging Python organization. And other things that DiffBy is using, for example, for some of the model fitting, for convex optimization, we use CVXPy. So DiffBy, to have DiffBy succeeding, it has to be maintained regularly, and all the other projects need to be growing well and in a sustainable way. And this has been established. I think the last years, it's really impressive what the Python community has done, and it's really wonderful to see many projects, including DiffBy, being easy to use, easy to install, and so on. So let me explain to you some of the things that we do. So what is the primary thing that makes DiffBy, let's say, more unique? It's that we basically implement state-of-the-art algorithms from the ground up using NumPy arrays as the main data structure. So that's what we do. We either an algorithm that we have invented, let's say I have invented, or some other author has invented. It may be in another language, it may be in a not written in a good way. We take this algorithm, we often talk also with the author of the algorithm, and we implement that algorithm in DiffBy. So, and we implement it from scratch to make it easy for people to understand how problems are being solved, how problems are being solved. So here you can see, for example, we have algorithms for registration, segmentation, modeling, optimization, tracking, and so on. So imagine now you have some diffusion data, they often called also DWI, the data standing for, that means diffusion weighted images. So you have this diffusion MRI data, and DiffBy, you can use DiffBy to, for example, denoise them, correct the motion, because maybe there is motion between each volume. Register them with a T1 image. Do some reconstruction using diffusion tensor imaging or diffusion ketosis imaging or other models. Do some tracking. Do the tractometry. So DiffBy provides algorithms and functions for all these problems and more. But this would be, for example, a single simple pipeline that takes you from the data to some statistical analysis and using tractometry. Tractometry is when you calculate statistics on the pathways, on the bundles themselves. And what is very important here is that also DiffBy allows you to visualize and inspect each output of these algorithms. Using a project called Horizon, we can visualize the data, we can see it, and you can save images or make videos and so on. So now you heard me saying pipeline, but we should explain here that DiffBy is not doing the job of what we are used in neuroimaging calling as pipeline software. So for example, for that, there are other projects. There is NiPipe, for example, that provides uses Python to connect to many different software, not only DiPy, but other software. DiPy is a library of ground up, from the ground up implemented algorithms. So we're not, except from a few dependencies that we have, we're not really using other diffusion software to do the analysis. So that helps a lot with releasing and with implementing. So here, for example, is an overview of implemented algorithms for signal reconstruction. So you can see here the famous DDI from Basser is implemented, or diffusion kurtosis imaging, DKI, from Jensen. So you will see here algorithms invented from other researchers and from us. You can see, for example, the SFM method from Ariel Rokian is implemented in DiPy, and so on. We have many of those. There are around 30 available, and each one of them, they're telling you something different for what the data, what the underlying data shows. So everyone provides a bit different information. And also we have been putting a big effort to implement modeling algorithms that require really latest acquisition techniques. For example, there is an acquisition technique called Q-space trajectory imaging and Q-space trajectory imaging plus, and now we have an effort there to implement it and make it available. And that would provide really latest modeling tools to researchers who work on the latest acquisitions. So we provide methods that work with any clinical acquisition, but also provide methods that work with latest research scanners and acquisitions. And that, of course, it's a lot of work and in maintenance and in implementing and testing again the new software, which we do heavily in DiPy. Now the installation is trivial for you all. You probably already have Anaconda installed. If you have Anaconda installed, all you need to do is open an Anaconda prompt if you are in Windows, or a terminal if you are in Linux or Mac, and then just do pip install DiPy. That provides all the analysis capabilities. And if you want also the visualization capabilities, you have to do as well pip install fuel. So if you do those two things, you have DiPy in your system and you should be ready to go. Now, if you are a developer, we also, you have to clone the project, and there is a bit different command here. It's again a pip install, but now you have to go in the folder and run a similar command like that to have a development version of DiPy. That's for people who want to develop. This easy solution is for everyone, and notice that all operating systems are supported. So here, by the way, let me know if you have any questions. I'm not sure if you're allowed to ask questions during the talk or at the end, but let me know.
Up to you, Eleftherios. Can people break in if they want to?
Yeah, sure. And here's some important links. So on the left, I have some, let's call it old links or standard links, and there's some new, more exciting links. So we have a website, it's at diepy.org, and that provides also access to an interactive chat room that you can use to ask quick questions. We have the source code in GitHub, and we have tutorials in the main website. And also there is a mailing list. You can subscribe at that at diepy@python.org. So those are the standard links. They have been there for quite a bit. However, now we have also a discussion forum that's quite new. This is where you can go and even like put a research topic, something that needs more discussion. It needs more elaboration. It's not a quick question. So we have that. And this is now some very good news, especially for NeuroHack Academy. It's the first time we do this. So we released a series of educational videos. The name of the channel is Diffusion Imaging in Python. And there we have videos where we explain exactly how each method works, what is the theory, and what command line you need to run, or what function you need to call from Python. And we just made available a full workshop series. It has 60 videos. Some of them are short, some of them are not short, but they provide you a really complete from novel to advanced introduction in using DiBi. And we're really excited about that. I hope you are too. So also we have open meetings, and they start from fall every 2 weeks. They're usually on Thursdays. So there will be an email about that in the mailing list. And of course, we run a workshop every year. It's usually in March, and it's a five days full workshop on DiBi. Okay, so let me take you now quickly to the website. So you go to diBi.org, okay, here you are, and then you can see here there is the installation instruction, and then there are links to different things that DiBi does. So you can click here and go to the relevant documentation. We have here on the right, on the corner, there is the chat room. This is the quick chat room. You can ask questions. Then, and this opens, and you will see here already many questions being answered, and be happy to ask new questions. Then there is this tutorials section where you can go here and see different tutorials. There are about 60 tutorials available. So if you are starting with DiBi, basically really just go here and start with these two tutorials. This first tutorial is how to read the data. And then this is how you can take the data and do some basic tracking. And then if you see here, there are many different other tutorials that takes you into pre-processing, denoising, reconstruction. Here, for example, if you are really starting, I suggest you read this tutorial on the tensor modeling, because it explains some of the theory as well, some of the metrics used, and so on. Most of the tutorials have some theoretical learning aspects too. And so this is the tutorial section. Then there is this gallery section that takes you into our educational content using videos. And that, if you click on any of those, will take you to this channel. So basically, this is the Diffusion Imaging Python channel. And here you will see, if you go to playlist, you will see there is this DiBi Workshop 2021 playlist that has this fully fledged educational course that takes you through all the steps with videos of Diffusion and explains how to use DiBi from different tasks, from understanding a bit more about neuroanatomy to doing harmonization, statistical analysis, and so on. So I definitely recommend you put that in your list of checks to think of things to check. Okay, so what else about that? Then this is yes, these are some of the links. I think I explained enough about that. So let me go back to my presentation. Okay, so how to use the IPI? We have scripts that you can run. So you can download the tutorial. There is a download link. You can download it from the website and run with Python or IPython, or you can use many notebooks provided and using Jupyter. However, we do have command line interfaces, and not only command line interfaces, but this is if you are used to command lines, you can use DiPy commands from the command line interface from a terminal to do some of the analysis. Okay, so when you use these command lines, have in mind that many of those, we call those DiPy workflows. And have in mind that there are available in many pipelines. So DiPy is already part of many pipelines. For example, every workflow, so every single of the of our interfaces in each release, it's automatically used in IPipe. So IPipe can take any DiPy workflow, any interface, and run it. And this is it's completely automated. So every DiPy release, if you have an IPipe, you can update DiPy, then you get the new interfaces automatically. Then there are also other systems like TractorFlow, M2G, QSIP. Those are all pre-processing pipelines that you can use, and they have DiPy, they use DiPy extensively. This is possible because we designed a system that takes DiPy functions and makes them automatically to interfaces. And this is really flexible. This is something that you can use also for other projects. So I suggest you, if you are working on development, look at how we developed our workflows. Apart from that, we have also web interfaces in Brain Life. There is a project called Brain Life that can run different analysis pipelines in the cloud. And there are many apps there that, many applications that run DiPy, and you can go to brainlife.io and use those. So in addition, we have data sets that we provide with DiPy. Most of them are already available and licensed for use from the public. And you can use a Python script to download these data sets, or you can use the command line to download them. For example, the command DiPy fetch list gives you the list of all the data sets that we provide. And we always keep trying to improve that. Also, you can, if you found which data set you want, then you can download that with specifying the name of the data set. And you can do the same from the Python script too. Now, something really exciting about DiPy is that many other libraries, not only pipelines or cloud systems, use it. It's also being used by other projects. So for example, there is DMyPy. There are many different projects that use DiPy. There is Amico and so on. There are many that use DiPy, but this is a new thing. This is a spin-off of DiPy. So in DiPy, we had more some visualization, that was starting becoming quite advanced. And some people in the community said, hey guys, why don't you create separate the visualization parts from the analysis part? So then we did that. We created a new project called Fury, that stands for Free Unified Rendering in Python. And that's a software project for scientific visualization. It is available at fury.gl and includes a library, a client-server system, and you can use what's called shaders to program very advanced visualization and scientific visualization effects, as you can see here. You can use it for network visualization and for many other things. And it allows you to interact very well with your data sets. And this is what we use internally to build now our own visualizations in DiPy for medical imaging purposes. And there is an educational, if you're interested about scientific visualization, be sure to watch this video here. There is an educational video in NanoBio. And this project was funded also by NSF. So this is a bit of an overview about DiPy and what you can do with it in general, and the spin-offs. And now I will focus on one new project, one exciting new project we have in denoising. But please remember that during this hack week, if you need any help to run any tutorials or try things, start from the quick start tutorial and just let me know, and we'll be happy to help and provide guidance. So now let's switch to one part of the methods provided in DiPy, which is denoising the data. Denoising is very early in the things you need to do to analyze your data sets. So it's something that everyone has to go through, and it is very important to talk about it. So this is work that I did together with my PhD student, Shreyas Patnavis, who is also the main author of the new method I will talk to you about in a few slides. So here is what we're going to talk about. We're going to give an overview of the denoising methods that are primarily used for diffusion, and then talk about the new method that's called patch to self, that provides and leads the new state of the art for denoising. And the methods we're going to talk about now are available in DiPy. You can use them. So diffusion MRI has noise. It has quite a bit of noise, especially if you go to clinical data, there is more noise, or if you go to high field data sets also, there is more noise there. And the problem with noise is that you can have different sources. You can have so many different sources, so many different reasons that create noise in the data. You can see some noisy data here. And this can make it difficult to model and remove. Here is an example. And that's the true model that you want to identify. You want to identify a signal that looks like this. But because of noise, you can fall to a wrong assumptions, to a wrong model, can shift your fitting, for example, to a different level. And get the wrong result. And it's an inverse problem. Often, a lot of the noise in MRI is due to thermal fluctuations, but there are many other reasons. It could be movement, it could be the difference in the blood circulation. There is a series of problems, and Noise, for example, can give you at the end many false tracks that you wouldn't get otherwise. So, and you probably wouldn't know that this is from noise, but often it is from noise. So what people have been doing so far is assuming different things. So let me start from smoothness. So many researchers have been assuming that there is some smoothness in the data sets. So the signal is locally smooth in a region, in the brain, in the diffusion data or other data sets, you assume that there is some local smoothness. And then you can use things like Gaussian smoothing or median smoothing. So this is a linear filter, this is nonlinear filter, which denoises a bit. And then you have some parameters you need to play with. And there are many in this category. You can have more advanced techniques like total variation norm or second order total variation. And so in that way, you have smoothness. The thing is that that smoothness is not always there. Most of the time is not there. And assuming it can create problems. And you will see some of the problems. So then you have other researchers that they're trying to solve denoising, assuming that the data has some lower rank approximation. So you can basically do some kind of PCA, principal component analysis, and use only a part of the data. And hopefully in the parts that you don't use, the noise will be there. And the good parts that you use, they will have all true signal, which is also not necessarily always correct, but nonetheless is a good idea. So we will see that. So there is the local PCA, and you basically do a PCA on every region in small patches in the brain. And there are also a method to automatically identify that rank that says how much low rank you will really be, how many of the eigenvalues of the systems you will use. Then there is the other researchers that provide assumptions for, that they assume some self-similarity. So images are often self-similar. Each patch in an image is similar to any other patches of the same image. So there is some similarity, regions are similar. And many people use block matching and 3D filtering techniques to solve that problem. And here you have non-local means and its variance, and you have also BM3D. Those are methods that assume self-similarity. The thing also is that, well, there is some similarity, but there is also a lot of dissimilarity. So you may be losing some information when you're using these techniques. Then there are some ideas that they take into account that there is sparsity in the data. And there you can use techniques like the discrete cosine transform, wavelets. You can also build some dictionaries. So those techniques assume some sparsity, and they're trying to build a dictionary of the data, and in that way use that dictionary to then denoise the data. And you can see here there is the overcomplete dictionary led by Aaron. There is denoising dictionary learning from Cranford, and so on. There are multiple techniques here. So we saw these techniques, and we saw that there is still space to be improved, although denoising is an old problem. And for that, we assume something completely different. We assume that the noise is statistically independent from the data. So we didn't assume things about the data, that they're smooth or self-similar, or we didn't have any strong assumptions for the data, but we did realize that noise is independent and that can be used to do denoising. So this technique that we present here is called Paths to Self, and it was presented in NeuroIPS at very recently, 2020, and is inspired partly from two papers, Noise to Self and Noise to Noise, that were also presented in machine learning. And have in mind that the low rank approximation, the self-similarity, and the statistical independence are all available in DiPi for comparisons. Also, of course, it's trivial to use some of the Gaussian median as well.
So, Eleftherios, just quickly, we're sort of at the end of the time here, so I thought maybe if you could wrap up in like 5 minutes.
Yeah, I'm actually going to finish really actually in 5 minutes. So, and hopefully less. So let me, okay, good. So let me go here and hit paste. Oh, sorry for that. Now to go very quickly to where I go, where I need. So here we are. So here are some of the techniques when I was explaining that you use, you're trying to find similar neighborhoods and update this. That's, for example, non-local means. And what you can see here, I'm using it as an example to see that what is not good here is that even though when you look at the result, the denoising looks pretty good, when you look at the residuals, the noise itself, by taking the difference of these two images, you see there is still some structure that you can still see some structure in the noise, and that's often not good. That's a way to understand if a denoising algorithm does a good job or not. So let me move to the latest approach. So this approach, as we said, puts the assumption on the noise and not on the signal, which is what was happening in the past. And that was inspired by this paper that basically took noise to noise, that took pairs of images, and they realized, oh, okay, the noise in the images, the two different images, is really independent, and you can use that to do the noising. The same, a similar principle was used by the noise to self paper, and this image C here is using the principle of J invariance, where basically, imagine you have this figure here, and you take some small patches. The noise in those patches is independent from the noise in the other patches. So what you could do, you could use the rest of the patches here to predict the values in one patch. So that's the main idea of noise to self. And they call this the property of J invariance. So now in our approach, we have this 40 data sets. So what we do, we actually hold out one volume of the data and use the rest of the volume to predict that data set. And then we basically, from the real data set, which was here, real volume to the predicted, we get the noise and we remove that noise. So as you have the different volumes here, imagine taking the volume for a specific gradient direction, taking it out and using the rest to predict them. So, so what we do, we train regressors on the held out volumes. And that allows us to basically try different regressors. So we tried a range of different regressors that So linear regressors, non-linear regressors, and so on. And we found something really impressive, that linear regression, we, using these self-supervised laws, what I explained before, that the idea of holding out in volume and using the others to predict it, it actually, a simple linear regressor, ordinary least squares, has incredible performance and outperforms the other methods. So basically what we do, we take the data, we hold one image, and with that, we hold out one image, and with the rest of the image, we build this design matrix. And then here, this is what we're going to predict, how the different volumes fit that matrix and go as close as possible to the measured image, to the one measured image. So then what you get as an output, you get a denoised output. And we repeat that for every volume, the same procedure. So imagine now that you have X is the noisy data, Y is the ground truth data, and J is the set of all dimensions in the noisy data, and we have small j is the held out dimension. By using the self-supervised laws, we can solve that problem, find the noise, assuming of course that the noise is independent across the different data sets, and especially the volumes. So, and that's the main idea. It's a very simple idea, and we keep repeating that process for each volume. And what you can see here, if you compare it with the pass to self with the data of, these are simulated data for different noise level, you will see that pass to self doing better at lower SNR, and can identify the ground truth from even very low SNR, signal to noise ratios. And it can overall come closer to the ground truth.
I'm serious, we kind of need to wrap up soon.
Yeah, so it's the last slide, I think, or it's one slide more, that's it. So here is results with the PBMI with different data sets. And here is the noise profile. And what you can see is that you don't get structure in the noise. It can improve dramatically the tractography result. This is also what we saw here. Reduce false positives and improve fitting. And you can use it not only for the brain, but you can use for heart, for spinal cord data sets that are very hard to deduce noise, for high field diffusion data sets that are very hard to denoise and get really good results. So thank you for your attention. I hope this was useful. There is a video also explaining the math behind that method. And make sure you subscribe to our mail list and to our YouTube channel. And thank you again for inviting me in this wonderful hackathon. Thank you.
Thanks, Eleftherios. Thanks for your presentation. So what we'll do is we'll, after the end of this call, maybe let's take 10 minutes for break and then resume for the tutorials at 10:48 at Pacific time. So we get a little bit break. Thanks again, Eleftherios. And if people have questions, go on to the Diffusion Imaging in Python channel on Slack, and we can take questions there.